What do you prefer? We have a discussion now, or we complete with your presentation? What it is better? Perhaps it's better to have a second presentation, and after we can open the discussion. Just a moment. And now we have Professor Haim Sadoun, the director of the Ben Tzvi Center Institute, and he's my friend, so I'm very glad to present him now today. And what it is interesting, he received this just not so long time.
Sorry.
You have to close there. The Haim Sadoun received the Distinguished President's Award of the President of the State of Israel, Moshe Katsav, in memory of the late President Ben Tzvi, and he is a member of the International Holocaust Remembrance Alliance, and he wrote many interesting articles and two books recently on the conditions of the Jews in Tunisia and in other areas of the North Africa. So I am very glad to give him the opportunity to present here his new research.
Okay, good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming. And what I will try to do in my presentation was to try to think about what is the meaning of a pogrom, what is the meaning of an outbreak, how can we look at the facts that we know about each pogrom, mainly the pogrom in Libya in 1945, but to see it in comparison to other pogroms in the Arab world that we know about them. We have much more knowledge than what you can think. So, as we all know, the importance of the pogrom of Tripoli in 1945 was that it was the first pogrom since the Ottoman occupation of Libya in 1935. We have very good documents from the Ottoman period, and as far as I know, there was not even one pogrom in Libya during this period. There was some, what I will call later, some outbreaks, some disturbances between Jews and Muslims, but not a pogrom as it was in 1945. But we know that the influence of this pogrom was very decisive. It influenced the decision of the community, the Libyan community, to immigrate from Libya. It was the 1945 pogrom and the next pogrom in 1948 that was part of the determination of the Libyan community to leave the country. And we know that, and we heard about it yesterday evening, afternoon, that this pogrom was an important factor of the collective memory of Libyan Jews. I can add something that is very important, that the first publications in Hebrew regarding the history of Libyan Jews was regarding the pogrom and not regarding Second World War. So if you want to see the comparison analysis of pogroms, we can see, and I give only a partial list of pogroms from the beginning of the 20th century to 1955, mainly, and most important is 1948, to see when it fell. And we see that there was, as far as we know, big pogroms, something that was influential in the community, is not so, there were not so many, mainly in North Africa, but even in all the Muslim lands. And the question is, why is this? I will not answer this question. I think that we have much more to do with other aspects of the presentation. So I will try to focus on my purposes of these lectures, is to suggest an analytic approach to understand what is a pogrom. This is the methodological point of view of my presentations, and to understand the pogrom in Libya in comparison to other pogroms. As we know, that there are many challenges to a comparative analysis. First of all, the sources that you have are not the same in each pogrom that we know. And more than this, yes, we don't have enough documents, or the variety of the documents or the sources are not the same in each case that we are looking and we are trying to understand. The second problem, or the second challenge, is the inclusion. Sometimes we are used to say that, look, you know that all the Arabs are the same. Oh, you know, this is the Arab attitude toward Jews from the Islamic period. This is the Arab attitude as it was over all the time. It's not changed. Now it's a pogrom, but this is what we know about the Arab attitude toward Jews, so it is not surprises. And this approach was sometimes even in the research that we used to look mainly on the rejections relationships between Muslims and Jews, and not other aspect of the coexistence of Jews and Muslims during the period or the ease or the places in which they lived. Moreover, mainly for us, the Israeli scholars that are looking at the subject, is to talk about the actualizations of these pogroms. Because we said, okay, you know, this was at the Arab lands, so even in the actual conflict between Israel and Palestine, it will be the same. Just recently, an article in the Israeli newspaper said that the pogrom in Orlando next week was the same as it was in the Farhud in Baghdad. It is the same hatred of Arabs against Jews over all the generations. So the actualization is something, a challenge that we should analyze in regard to these pogroms. And of course, the collective memory of the community. Normally, we are used to have something in our memory that is more deeper when we are talking about the pogrom and not about the coexistence between Jews and Muslims. So what was amazing in the research on the pogrom of Libya in 1945, that there are rarely documents regarding this subject. We have only three important documents, which I'll show you in a minute, that mainly are British documents. We have almost none documents from the Jewish community of Tripoli or other places, other towns in Tripolitania. We have oral testimonies, and we have a lot of oral testimonies regarding this subject. But there are, in the first time, and I will show you at the end of my presentations, that at the first time we have a very, very detailed knowledge regarding all the damages that were during these riots. As far as I can say, from all the riots which I explored in my researches, is that the only one that we have the exact number and the exact names and the exact damages that were during this pogrom. So those are the three documents that we have regarding the subject. I have in here. It's not the same documents. Each of those three documents. This is the Central Zionist Archive. This is the PRO, the National Archives of England. Now, at the beginning, it was known as the Public Record Office. Today, it's the National Archive. This is from the Zionist Central Archives in Jerusalem. But as far as I know, it was written by one of the British administrations in Libya. I unfortunately, there is no sign who wrote the document, who is signed on this document. And this is the third document. There are differences between the documents. I will not have the time to examine it to see what are the differences between each document, but I used three of them to understand the violent outbreak in Libya. So let's go to the methodological aspects of the presentation. I will try to give some definitions to give a general overview of what is the meaning of a pogrom. So as you know, the word pogrom is not used in Muslim lands. It was taken from what we know in the situation between the relations between Jews and Christians in Europe, and it was adapted to the situations in in the Muslim land. So I will try to say that, look, if you can make a generalizations of the disturbances between Jews and Muslims, we can talk about incidents that are something that it's something that was beyond what we call the normative relations. I cannot say what is the normative relation. We'll see it in a minute, that it's also an aspect in the pogrom of Libya, but there is something that is normal. If to crush Jews, it's normal, so this is the normative relations. When we are going to a violent incident, that it's more, it's something that was in which we have wounded in the violence, and it was not during the incident, but the most important is to try to define what I'm calling the violent outbreak. It's mean any incident in which there are fatalities, deaths. The number of the fatalities determine the significance of the outbreak. If you said it was a very, very strong outbreak, a violent outbreak in the relationships between Jews and Muslims, so the significance of the outbreak of the violence in the community's life, both in regard to the locations and the collective memory. The number of fatalities will also determine the relations between the sites during their lifetime. So if we say, as it was in the case of Tripoli in 1945, that it's determined that the Jews will not be able to live anymore in Libya. Is this is the only reason why they left Libya? I'm not sure about it. I think that there are more political process in Libya that determine this decision, but this is one of them. So if we want to go deeper to analyze the outbreak or the violent outbreak in all the Muslim lands, I think that we have to make separations between the causes, and the causes, that means what is the basis causes, that means the relationship between Islam and Judaism, what were the exact circumstances of each violence, of each pogrom, and what is the catalyst, that means what was the reason that we have now a pogrom in such or such a country. So the second question is it was planned or it was spontaneous? Do we know that there was a plan to make such and such pogrom? What are the sites that were involved in the outbreak? Do we have a structure? I think yes, of an outbreak. What is the scope? That means the point of no return in each outbreak. What is the nature of the violence? I will show you an example in a minute. The time, I think that we have what we can call the August syndrome in pogrom. And it's not only in Muslim countries, it's in over all the world. There were researchers that made by sociologists that shows that mainly in the in August there are more pogroms between sites in each country than in other times. What was the immediate result and long-term ramifications, damages or property casualties in each pogrom, and what we know about the outbreak in the collective memory? I think that this can give us a panorama of all the topics that are that we should look when we are when you want to make a research regarding a violent outbreak. So if you go deeper to see what were the causes or what can be the causes of each pogrom, we can say that the basic causes are always the Islam attitude towards Jews in all the countries, and the place of the Jews, the place that the Jews took place, the place of the Jews in each society. Sometimes there is differences between the Islam attitude towards Jews and the place of the Jews in the society, and the attitude of the Jews throughout history, whether there had been outbreaks in the past. This can determine the basic causes. When you are going to see the circumstances, and there is difference between the causes, the basic and the circumstances, we can talk about what happened in Tripoli. Just for an example, is the ongoing political crisis. For example, the war 1940-1942 in Libya, and the role that the British military administration took place during this period. Did the Palestinian conflict influence the situations in Tunisia, or was some of the circumstances of the outbreak? I think that we cannot determine. I will show you later what the documents are saying regarding this point of view or these circumstances of the pogrom in Libya in 1945. And of course, we have to look at the catalyst. I will try to go deeper to see what happened in Libya. But if you take just for example what happened in the Farhud in June 1941 in Iraq, we know that there was a revolution in Iraq. We know that it was during a holiday, that means the Shavuot holiday. It's a Jewish holiday, very known at this period of the year. And of course, the defeat of the Iraqi soldier during the war, during the Second World War, against the British that came to another time. It was the second time that they came to Iraq. All this influenced the catalyst of the disturbance between Jews and Muslims near what we call the graves of the prophet Yechezkel in Baghdad. So what are the sites that involved in a violent outbreak? It's not just simple to say, it's okay, it was the Muslims against the Jews, and there was also the colonial rulers that were part of the violent outbreak. I think that if we want to go deeper, we have to see who were the country leaderships, that means the head of the state, the religious figures, if there were political figures that were involved, who were the local leaderships? Because you know that in the case of the riots in Tripoli, there was differences between what happened in the capital and what happened in the local, the small towns in the country. And there are very big differences between them. So who is the city government? Who is the religious figures at each local, in each town? What was the role of the rural population or the tribes? We know that even in the Farhud in Iraq, even in the pogrom in Constantine in 1934, even during the pogrom in Tripoli, what we call the rural population came and took part in those pogroms, and we have to try to understand what was the exact role that they took during these riots. And of course, we have to see what who were the Jews, or who from the Jews took part in the riots, the national leaderships, the urban leaderships, and what we can say the ordinary people during this period. And last is the colonial regime. In most of the Muslim countries in the 20th century, there was a colonial regime, or there were aspects of influence or colonial regimes on those in those countries. And they can, we know from their rule during the riots that they could stop or they could leave the riots to develop, or they could stop it if they wanted to do it. And there was also, in most of the cases, there was blame that they didn't want to stop the riots because it served them in the way of ruling the country. So I think that we, from all what I said till now, that we can talk about the structure of a violent outbreak. And the violent outbreak, it's the beginning, the catalyst. How does the outbreaks begin? How does the violence spread in all over the country? Who spread it and how? The responses of local and community and countrywide leadership to the catalyst, to what happened at the first catalyst, the first disturbances between Jews and Muslims. And then come the second part, is the unfolding of the outbreaks, how long it's last. We know that in Tripoli it was 3 or 4 days, it depends on the sources, but from other pogroms that we know, it took 2 or 3 days at least in each pogrom. Why it took so much time, if it is so much? Does the intensity of the violence grow increasingly? Which is the hardest day in the pogrom? Where does the violence take place? In the course of the events, were spontaneous or plain? What happened during the interval in the violence? It was an increasingly violence that came over the 2 or 3 days, or there was some breaking in the violence, and how an outbreak come to an end, how it's ended, when we know that it was finished or it was not finished, and who is deciding about if it was finished or not finished, what steps are taken to end the violence. So let's try now to see what, if you want to take the comparison between, what, for example, the duration of such programs in Muslim lands, we can see the differences between what happened, for example, in Casablanca in 1907 and what happened in Libya and Tripoli in 1948. There are differences as far as we know. Did the villagers, the rural population took place, yes or no? In most of the cases, we know that they took place during the violent outbreak. Investigation committee, and we know only in three cases, in Algeria in 1943, in Iraq in 1941, and in Aden in 1947, that there was an official investigation committee, yes, they tried to understand what happened during this period. In the other cases, as far as I know, there was no investigation community. And did the Palestinian issue affected the situation in those outbreaks? As far as I know, there is no any influence in the first in Casablanca, in Fez, and in Constantine. But when we are going deeper to see for the 14th of the 20th of the 20th century, there is an increasing influence of the Palestinian conflict on the relationships between Jews and Muslims. And sometimes it's happened that those disturbances come to a pogrom, come to a more intensive riot. So if we want to see another factor in comparison to other, in Tripoli, in comparison to other pogroms in Muslim lands, we can see the differences between what we call the catalyst in the in each cases in Casablanca in 1907, in Constantine, there is a mistake here, it's the incident of the Zuab Eliyahu Khalifa, who cursed the Muslims when they were praying in a mosque near his house. That means that the catalyst was a religious factor and not something else. Sometimes it's a political, sometimes it's political and religious. For example, the Farhud in Iraq, the circumstances were during the Shavuot holiday, Jewish holiday, but there was a political catalyst. That means that the defeat of the Iraqi soldiers in the war. In Tripoli, it was, I think, mainly political. I didn't find any religious factor or any religious catalyst in the beginning of this pogrom. But perhaps, and I say only perhaps, I will go deeper to this question later, if the Palestinian conflict influenced the pogroms. If you want to go, this is the map of Tripoli. Unfortunately, I don't have all the names in English, but of course this is Tripoli, and we know that the riots took place in Amarus, in Tajoura, in Msalta. In the documents you call it Kasabat, and it was also in Sbarta and Zawiya. That means that it go from Tripoli outside to the other little town around Tripoli, but it didn't go to Cyrenaica, it didn't go down in the south to Garyan and other places. So what was the real catalyst in Tripoli in 1945? As De Felice mentioned in his book, he said that in the later afternoon on Sunday, November 4th, the president, that means Zakino Habib at this time, of the Jewish community received news of the first serious attack, which occurred simultaneously. That means that it was not only a small event in such a sad place in Tripoli, but it was something more spread in the city of Tripoli or perhaps even in other places, but I'm not sure that this is the only reason. If you want to go deeper to see, I think that you can see it, to the documents, it said that all accounts, this is from the report that we have from the Zionist archives, all accounts of the riot agree on this one point, that the riot started on Sunday evening, November 4th, at about 6:30 p.m. near the electric power plant, which is located outside of the Hara. That means not in the Jewish quarter of Tripoli. Minor disturbances between hooligan gangs of Arab and Jews had taken place here before. That means that's what we can call the normative relationship between Jews and Muslims. It was nothing that changed from what we know at the past in the cases of disturbances between Jews and Muslims. Nobody thought that the disturbances were out of ordinary. What's mean ordinary? That means that they were used to Arabs, hooligans are attacking Jews. I have disturbances between Jews and Arabs. And what is amazing in the words out of ordinary, that means that we can accept that between Jews and Arabs, there are disturbances that we can live with, but not with pogroms. However, within a few minutes, Jews were attacked with sticks and clubs throughout the city. That means that those disturbances that were ordinary, yes, in the relationships between Jews and Muslims spread to the city, and something changed in the city. So where it was organized, that sometimes it's the only thing that's interesting in understanding of the riots, and it said in one of the sources, only Jews and Jewish shops were attacked. Well-dressed Arabs were seen choking the doors of homes and shops with the words Jews, Italian, Arabs in Arabic. That means you have the same descriptions from what happened in Constantine in 1943. That means that in the second day of the pogrom in Tripoli, someone wrote in a report that we know that Arab came to the shops of Jewish silvermen in the Jewish quarter of Constantine and choked the door and said, "This is a Jew, this is an Arab, here you can do your pogrom, here don't touch the places." So when it was? It was in the first day, the second day, the third day, we don't know exactly, but it seems that someone tried to say, only be careful when you are during the riot, don't pay attention, that can be something that you can touch an Arab home or a shop. That means that there is some aspect of coexistence between Jews and Muslims. They will look like the same in their closets, they will look like the same in the houses, in the shops, and if you don't know exactly whose shop is, yes, you may, of course, it can be very serious, you can may attack an Arab and not a Jew. What arms and method were used during this pogrom? So from another source, we can read this. In order to carry out the slaughter, the attackers used various weapons, knives, daggers, sticks, clubs, iron bar, revolvers, and even hand grenade. Generally, the victim was first struck on the head with a solid, blunt instrument, and after being knocked down, was finished off a knife, and I don't want to read the last of the sentence, what happened to the head of those who were knocked down. That means that even there was an aggravation in the using of arms, of weapons, during the what we can call ordinary relations between Jews and Muslims. When you are using those weapons, that means that there was something deeper in the relationship, something that influenced the riots. So why did the riots last so long? Why it took 3 or 4 days? And from the sources, what we can learn is that the riot lasted from Sunday evening throughout Wednesday, it means 3 or 4 days on Wednesday night, because of the authority did not control or check them. The police failed to fulfill its functions, act slowly and indecisively. That means that the authorities have something to do with that they can't stop the riot? Did they understood what's going on, or they thought that this is the ordinary relations between Jews and Muslims? We cannot know because of the lack of documents that you have from this riot, because of the lack of Jewish or other documents that we should have to determine this function. What was the interest of the authorities not to act decisively during the first day or the second day of the pogrom? Unfortunately, we don't know. So did the Palestinian questions affect this riot? Okay, so the ordinary hypothesis is that the Zionist activity among the Tripolitanian Jews, this I of course skipped, this activity was one of the provocation of the riot. So this is the assumptions that we know that was used to be said regarding the riots. But if you are going to go deeper, we know we can see this statement. So this statement are of great significance. At the same time, they tend to confuse the issue because the Palestinian question and Zionism are strange concepts to the overwhelming majority of the Tripolitanian Arab, effect on which all intelligent Arab agree, and that the Zionist activity among Tripolitanian Jews would be meaningless to the Tripolitanian Arab. That means that if we want to go deeper to see the impact of the Palestinian conflict or the Palestinian issue on the causes or the basic causes or the catalyst of this pogrom, I'm not sure that it influenced them very much because, as it said here in one of the perceptions of the documents, that it was not something that was real, that had a real effect on those relationships. On those relationships, it was not one of the catalyst of the pogrom in Tripolitania. This is a very interesting point of view of the attitude of the Arab regarding Zionist activity, regarding the Israeli Palestinian conflict in 1945. So this is something that I found in one of the newspapers, in the New York Times. At the beginning, they saw that there were only 74 Tripolitanian Jews, but as we know, there was more during this period. So let's see what were the outcomes of the program. And here I think that we have very interesting figures that came from the sources that we can see here. Of course, Tripolitanian. I put it the number of the populations, Jewish populations in Tripoli during this period, and what happened in Amarus, Tajua, Zanzu, Zawiya, and Kasabat. The number of victims were, of course, 130. It's a lot. It's a very huge number to the old populations of Libya during this period. But from the sources, we can see who was slaughtered, who was killed during this period. It's the only. It's the first time that we can see the exact age of each of the victim in this pogrom. We don't have it from other pogroms. We even don't have the names of those who were killed in other pogroms as we have it in this special case of Tripoli. So let's here you can see the list of the names, and we have the list of the names, the ages in each town in Tripoli during the violent outbreak in Tripoli 1945. We have the number of wounded, not with the name of those wounded, but we have, of course, the number. Something is very interesting is to see that the documents are giving also the names of the widows and the orphans of the fallen Jews. This is something new that we don't know from other pogroms in Muslim countries, so we have here all the names. We have also the list of claims, some bit for compensations from the British administration in Libya. It's very detailed with all the number and all the names of those who claim for compensations. We have 13 claims for shops and factories which plundered or damaged during the pogrom, and we have it here even in the details of what exact shops it was that was damaged during the pogrom. And we have also the outcomes of those who were accused, condemned, acquitted, or absolved after the riots. What did the British authority did to do to those who were, who took part in the riots? Those are photos of the grave. I think it's 1945. Unfortunately, I cannot be sure, but all the documents, all the all what we know is that those are the graves of those who were killed in the pogrom of 1945. If you will have time, I will show you other photos that I have from other pogroms. This is not the same. And just to go to some conclusions, so we can see the circumstances, we can see the catalyst, the time that it took, the scope of the outbreaks, and the planning, if it was planned or not planned. But if I want to go deeper to see what really think a Jewish North African intellectual regarding the overview of a pogrom, of the meaning of a pogrom in Muslims' lands. So as you know, one of these intellectual, of Jewish intellectual, is Albert Memmi. Albert Memmi is an author, is a sociologist, a psychologist, is very famous author of many books regarding Tunisian Jews, regarding colonialism, and the portrait of colonized and colonizer. And it is a very important figure in the North African Jewish intellectual. And he said in the in his book, Jews and Arabs, he is one of the defender of Arab nationalism, of Arab of Tunisian independence. And he said, the truth is that we lived a life of fear and humiliations in Arab countries. I will not speak here of different matter, but of different matter, that of the massacres of before Zionism. I'm keeping the list for you, 1907 in Casablanca, 1912 in Fez, 1934 in Constantine, Ujda 1948, Egypt 1948, Aden 1947, Iraq in 1944, 1945 in Tripoli. And then he go on and say, therefore, in the days of colonial rule, the Jews enjoyed a certain degree of security. Also, they remain second-class citizens who from time to time were subject of outbreaks of popular rage, which they enslaved. French, English, or Italian would not always help it time, whether out of apathy or calculation. So that means that they lived in such a situation even during the colonial period. But another important Jewish intellectual, Andrei Shuraki, he was born in Algeria, he's very famous, very known, he died, and he said in his very famous book, The Jews in North Africa, in the meantime, the Jews lived in close contact with their Muslims fellow countrymen. They lived, in fact, in inseparable symbiosis. He's the first, he's the only one, I think, that is talking about those interesting terms, inseparable symbiosis. And the massacres, what we call the pogrom, whenever it would appear, was not like a pogrom which had been planned ahead of time and was carried out in cold blood, as happened frequently in Europe over generations. So he makes a separation between the pogroms in Europe and the pogroms in Muslim lands. Popular outbreaks against Jews in throughout the history of North Africa were characterized more by a robbery and looting than by murder. Also that we saw that is murder, that means that he wants to minimize the relationships, the importance of the outbreak in the history of the Jews in those countries. So what will be the meaning of an outbreak? How can we look at it? I think that, I hope that from the methodological aspect and what we know from what happened in Tripoli, this is the topic of my lecture, of course, I think that we have to go deeper and to look more carefully when we are talking about the pogrom in every place, but mainly what is more interesting for us today, what means the pogrom in a Muslim country. And if you will have time, I will just go fast to show something that some pictures that we have from other pogrom. This is the ruins of the Melach in Fez during the outbreak of 1912. We have Jews that were sitting on the ruins of the Melach, and we have trying to rebuild the Melach. And all those photos were published publicly. We have a soldier that are keeping the Melach after the riots of 1912, and we have also the army that came to protect the Melach in Fez. I will skip on. Okay, no. This is what we know from what happened, what last in Constantine 1944 after the pogrom. We have also photo very interesting that you can see here. I think it's a soldier here or an Arab. This is the only photo that we can see what happened during the pogrom, during the outbreak. Of course, in the left side, you can see what was left from the Jewish quarter. This is the funeral of the victim of the pogrom in Constantine in 1943. Those are the graves, and I'm sure that those are the graves of the victim in Constantine. In Ujda, in June 1948, we see at this photo the digging of the graves of the Jews in the town of Ujda. It's a frontier town between Algeria and Morocco. We can see wounded that are taking, or perhaps death, I don't know, killed person that is taken. I think it's by Jews, but I cannot be sure. We see here the imam and the imam of Ujda, the Muslim imam of Ujda, and the French authorities that are coming to the funeral of the Jews. And here we can see the funeral from the city to the cemetery in Ujda. I think that's all. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you. Now we have the opportunity for a discussion. It is, we have 40 minutes about, so a long time. So we can open the discussion. Please, just a moment, would you come here if you want to say something? Or if someone want to help me, we can give that. Potrebbe lei darmi una mano?
We have only 10 minutes.
10 minutes?
10 minutes.
Oh, okay, okay. So a few minutes, but after we have more time.
It will be enough.
Also your name, we need it because we are recording.
Sure. So I'm Valerie McGuire. Thank you to both presenters for two excellent papers. I actually have questions for both, or comments and questions. What's that? Closer. Okay. Here we go. So Haim, I was really intrigued by this description you gave of the moment when they were writing in Arabic, each the Italian, Jew, Arab on the doors, and it reminded me of a sort of similar process that you hear about that happened in India at the fall of the British Empire between Muslims and Hindi. And so I was wondering, related to that, if also the question of how much the Palestinian question entered in, if you're able to see in the documents how much the Palestinian question was affecting the riots, if you have any sense of that, because I'm wondering to what degree this was sort of a civil war that was just waiting to happen, and just the lid was being kept on by different imperial structures. So it's something along these lines. And for Patrick, thank you also, a very, very interesting paper. I really liked this idea of showing the collaboration, the potential for collaboration between the Nazis and the fascists. As I understand it from the reading I've done, that although there may have been some collaboration, the relationship, at least between Mussolini and Hitler, was quite tense and quite competitive. So I did wonder too, and I was also struck by the pictures that you showed at the end of the Tunisian Jews in work camps, which you had found in German archives, if you were able to find similar pictures in Italian archives or if they don't exist, and to how you would describe, thinking through how you would describe this relationship. I mean, there's always this cliche of Mussolini that you're trying to reverse, but there's always this cliche of Mussolini playing sort of second fiddle to Hitler. But if there aren't some new, more nuanced ways about thinking about that relationship too, as well. Okay, thank you.
Professor Chetri.
Thanks. Thanks for the two good lectures. But my question is directed to Chaim. The ambiguous politics of the colonial rule in Libya. It was not so ambiguous. My question is if the Libyan Jews did not pay the rebellion of the Yishuv against Britain, against the colonial rule, and the politics, the silence of the British authority in Tripoli was in fact a revenge against the Yishuv. And the Libyan Jews paid for the Palestinian Jews at that epoch. Thanks.
I'm Martino Pizzi. Thank you very much for the both presentations. I have just a very short question to pose to Patrick Bernard, involving the documents in the archives. I'm studying the Tunisian context, and so I'm very interested. I'd like to know if, for example, in German archives are conserved some documents concerning the direct involvement or the collaboration of Italian authorities with Germans, because in Italian diplomatic archives I don't found I didn't find a lot of these papers. So
I am Liliana Picciotto. Thanks for the excellent lectures. I am referring to Bernard's presentation with the interesting thesis of a mutual influence between Nazism and fascism in enforcing anti-Semitism in the Italian colonies. I'm not completely convinced of this thesis. I think that we have rather to see carefully on the steps of Italian official anti-Semitism enforced in Italy, much more than on the influence of Nazi Germany ideology, practice, and aims, both in Italian territory itself as in the colonial as well. As we know, on October 1938, the Italian fascist government began to enact anti-Jewish laws that were soon extended to the Libyan colony in the form of the governor decrees, waiting for a proper law that was specifically prepared for Libyan Jews. This war law, the Royal Legislative Decree number 1420, was issued on October 9, 1942. Just a few months before the liberation of Libya by the British Army. The title of this law was Limitations of Capacity of Belongings to the Jewish Race in Libya. Without waiting for the official issue of this law by a governor decrees, the young Jews has been expelled from Italian schools, professionals cast away from their work. These Jews, considered politically dangerous, interned in camp of the Jura and of Buerat el-Sun and Hun in the southern desert. Furthermore, following the special Italian decree for the forced labor for young Jews in Italy, since July 1942, 1,000 Libyan Jews were being conscripted for forced labor to be performed in the Sidi Aziz Azaz camp, 150 kilometers south of Tripoli, at Bukbuk in Cyrenaica on the border with Egypt, near Tobruk, and Buerat el-Sun. I defend the idea that all these decrees and the practices were an extension of racial laws very typical of fascist antisemitism, and I think could be enforced even without the Nazi ideology influence or political pressure. I ask you more comments on that. Thank you.
Now that we have your answer.
Yeah, maybe I start from the head. Valerie, I mean, you asked a very broad question, no? About the relationship between Hitler and Mussolini. And I mean, this is my basic argument, yeah? That there is a very strange mixture of, let's say, envy, admiration, repelling the other dictator. Indeed, what I try to do is to understand these relations a little bit in more nuanced terms. No, I mean, our scholars have more emphasized conflict, misunderstanding. No, to the point that people argue now that this the alliance was, you know, doomed to failure right from the beginning because, yeah, they disagreed. Especially in terms of race and anti-Semitism, no? That there was no substance in the end to maintain a solid alliance. And I think we have to, you know, look more actually what they did together. Yeah, because it's astonishing to see to me that there's still no history of the Axis, no? I mean, people already think they know what happened, and I think that was the reason why we don't have thorough empirical research on various aspects of Axis collaboration. No? I mean, so far we didn't have anything on police collaboration, on collaboration as far as city planning is concerned. No, major field also colonialism, agrarian contacts, yeah, and so on and so on. So far, I had the impression researchers have focused more on those fields in which the contacts did not run smoothly, no? Military cooperation, for instance, no? So I think it's time to look more at fields beyond, you know, these traditional fields of international cooperation, such as the military diplomatic relations, no? To look also at the broad basis of both societies, no? Look at kind of local projects as town twinning projects that existed in the 1930s to get a more nuanced picture. And I think when you have a closer look, you will see that there's a lot of admiration. At the same time, there's competition. And I would argue that the competition in a way fueled Axis relations, no? They wanted to outdo each other. At the same time, they collaborated. Yeah, so there's a lot of dynamics going on, and I think that's something we have to acknowledge a little bit more in future research. Pictures. I mean, it would be very grateful to anyone here in the audience if you could, you know, point out if there are any holdings of photographs, yeah, on Italian North Africa, because I, so far, I mean, I found a little bit in, let's say, in the official documents, no? Sometimes there are photos attached, for instance, of Jews greeting the British as liberators, yeah? Because these photos were used to target these Jews later on as traitors, no? Yeah? Yeah? Collaborating with the enemy, no? Greeting the British, for instance, no? So we have a little bit, but I'm not aware that there is, you know, also in that there are private holdings of photos. Something that I deeply regret, and I mean, we have some experts here. Maybe someone can tell us if Italian soldiers shot pictures of the North African campaign, because for the German case, it was quite common for German soldiers to take photos. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Okay. So maybe this is kind of a German particularity, no? Okay, yeah, I'm not, as far as Professor Picciotto's remarks are concerned, I'm not sure if we are completely disagree. I had the impression that this is very much in line with what I actually said, yeah? That there is a genuine policy, fascist policy of anti-Semitic persecution in North Africa. However, there is some sort of interrelationship with the Germans as well. I think we should not exclude that, because otherwise, I mean, how would you, for instance, explain that there is a Jewish council, an Italian Jewish council in Tunisia, if we don't consider the presence of the Germans as well? Yeah, but I mean, my basic argument was, where I differ from previous accounts is that I see a different motivation behind the Italians to adopt certain techniques and measures of anti-Semitic persecution. No, this is not kind of an opportunism. No, this is in also in line with this old narrative and the old idea that we have of Mussolini as some sort of funny sidekick to Hitler. No, completely of a completely ridiculous dictatorship somewhere south of the Alps. But they actually had, their own racial agenda, their own anti-Semitic agenda. But this is exactly why they were so interested in, very specific German know-how of how to oppress people. Yeah, that is my kind of third. It's kind of a third way of, explaining the events in North Africa. Post revisionist account. Yeah.
Two of the questions were Valerie and Professor Chitrit were regarding the effect of the Palestinian conflict on those relationships between Jews and Muslims. And my answer will be as follow. We had pogroms before, 1940, but if you want to check carefully all the details, all the facts that we know about pogroms in Muslim lands, from 1940 to 1949, there were more pogroms in Muslim lands than it was before, in the 20th century, of course, and what happened after, that's mean on the 15th and the 16th in those countries. So if we go from this point of view, we can say that the Palestinian issue affected the relationships between Jews and Muslims. So the question is how far it influenced those relationships. I'm not sure that I can say that it was part of the real causes, the fundamental causes of the pogroms. But it had a side effect of something more to those relationships between, as far as can understand, and this is to Professor Chitrit, what happened in Tripolitania in 1945 was more the attempt of the Arab to gain something from those riots. That means that they wanted to show to the United Nations that just was created in Europe, that Libya should have its own independence, and that the British, of course, they knew about it. Of course, they knew about it. But they wanted to prove to the British that they cannot control now the country as the Italian controlled the country before, and Libya should have its own independence. So to understand it in the colonial relationships and the struggle of the nationalist movement to independence, this is the only reason of that we can have from such a pogrom, because why it was not before? Why it was not in 1942, in 1941, why it was not even before? Not to let them to protect the, not to let them
to leave the camp for helping Jews.
It's a fact from the little documents that you have from this. I tried to find testimonies of Jewish soldiers from that period, and unfortunately there is no, just nothing. We know the fact that you told just yet that you just said from other sources, but we don't know it from Jewish soldiers that were at that period in Libya. So what I tried to say even in the beginning, that the importance of this riot from one hand, and on the other hand, the lack of documents that really can give us more details regarding this pogrom is very known. We just don't have enough documents. We have only three fundamental documents and some other letters that were written mainly in British archives, but in the Zionist archives or in private archives. Since now, unfortunately, I didn't find any more documents. And even from the oral testimonies, if you'll check some of them, they're not speaking about these subjects. Yes? So, but yes, the Palestinian issue had an effect on Jews-Muslim relations, mainly after 1941. Yes? Perhaps. Okay.
Okay, we have a large problem to explore, very large aspects that we have to explore. Just I would like to suggest a possibility to integrate your historical research with an anthropological approach, because it is not possible to understand well and to compare the Arabic world, the Islamic world, and the European world without this capacity to understand the different aptitude. I think that to go inside the questions and to avoid some mistakes that we have in Europe sometimes when people are studying Arabic world and Islamic culture and the concept of ummah, how it is working inside the Arabic world, I think it is interesting to combine. We could combine together with other colleagues and to go on in this research. I think it would be very important also for today to understand how today memory is used by the different sides in the Middle East debate. Okay, thank you. We have now a little break and we can go to drink our coffee.
Start. Good morning. My name is Liliana Picciotto. I am chief of historical researchers at the Milan Center for Contemporary Jewish Documentation, CIDEC, and the co-organizer of this meeting, along with Professor McNagy's Roma Tre University and Haim Tzadon Ben Zvi Institute. Yesterday, Professor Shakrit, è qua? No, sì. Referred to persistence in the past of tradition and religiosity of Libyan Jews. And Professor Roumani added from the public the notion of the extraordinary capacity of them to adapt themselves to whenever situation. And that called to my mind a story that I want to tell you. Few years ago, in exactly in 24, I met a man, Herzl Reginiano, in Israel, whose family, a British citizen, was arrested in January 1942 by Italian authority in Tripoli. And as Jewish enemy of Italy, was transferred to Italy. Families Reginiano, Labi, and others were confined in a small village near the city of Bologna. The village was named Bazzano. In that village, in the autumn of 1943, they were all arrested by the German police, and these families, totaling 59 people, were deported to the lager of Reichenau near Innsbruck, when all of them suffered starvation, cold, and so on. Women and men were slept separately. And the Nazi obsession for order and cleanliness was enforced in this camp like in other camps. The mother of Herzl Reginiano had taken her husband's tallit along from Tripoli. The tallit is the prior shawl, the Jewish prior shawl. And she was ordered to clean the floor with this tallit. She managed secretly to rip the fringes with the tzitziot and to have them delivered to the men's dormitory. And then, as she had been ordered, she used the tallit cloth, deprived of the fringes, to clean the floor. Mr. Herzl also remembers that his mother perfectly memorized the Jewish calendar of that year. She so knew when it was Passover. At the eve of Passover, she sent out their daughters to collect radishes, and with the green herbs of the radishes, she was able to celebrate at least Maror, one of the points of the Pesach Seder, as a symbol of the old traditional Passover celebration. I think these episodes are the sign of the extraordinary attachment of Libyan Jews to their tradition. Now, let me present Professor Roumani. Where is it? Thank you. Professor Roumani is the well-known political scientist and the most leading expert on Libyan Jews and Jewish refugees. His research interests include migrations, minorities, and Jewish-Muslim relations. He teaches political sociology at the Middle East at Ben Gurion University of the Negev, where he introduced the interdisciplinary study of Sephardi and Oriental heritage. His book, his most recent book, is The Jews of Libya, Coexistence, Persecution, Resettlement, which is now in Italian edition. His lecture is The Consequences of the Fascist Deportation of Libyan Jews to Tunisia.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My paper today is a brief summary of a major study on the deportation of Tunisian French citizens from Libya to Tunisia between 1940 and 1945. I deal mainly with one specific chapter of the war, and that is La Marsa 1943. My talk is divided in three parts, and if time permits, a fourth part. Number one, the situation in Libya and Tunisia between 1940 and 1942. Two, the Tunisian campaign, 1942-1943. And third, the bombardment of La Marsa on March 10th, 1943. Reports based on pilots about their mission and testimonies of survivors. The fourth part, if we have time, the repatriation of Libyan Jews between 1944 and 1945. To be honest, my main goal in this paper was to ascertain how La Marsa was bombarded and by whom. As it will become clearer, there is a personal reason for this investigation. I also intend to set the record straight as to the exact figures of the deportees from Libya to Tunisia, both Jews and Muslims. My research, which took years, was based on archival documents, photos, and panoramic air surveys from military establishments in the US and Britain. Books did not help. While they had detailed description of the campaign in North Africa, the date of March 10, 1943 was conspicuously absent. For example, the four-volume book, The Mediterranean and the Middle East by Major Playfair, dealt exclusively with the destruction of the Axis forces in Africa and says nothing, but nothing, about La Marsa. Others would discuss February 1943 and then skip to April and June. If a book mentioned March 10, 1943, it may have been only one line or half without any footnote. This increased my curiosity and determination to get to the bottom of that data. And now to the paper, the first part. We know that the racial laws enacted by Italy in 1938 did not find immediate application in Libya, thanks to the politics of the governor Italo Balbo. However, a change in the Italian policy towards foreigners living in Libya occurred in 1941 with the appointment of a new governor, General Ettore Bastico, on July 19, 1941, and the unfolding war events. On one hand, it was important for the Italian authorities to implement an anti-Jewish discrimination in the colony and even a comprehensive anti-Jewish legislation against Jews of Italian Libyan colonial citizenship granted to local Libyans and to impose the restrictions with greater severity, quotes. On the other hand, the Italians sought to remove all foreign citizens either by sending them to concentration camps or to their home countries, in the case of the French citizens and Tunisian protected, or to Italy for the British subjects. The legislation failed to be effectively implemented because of war events. But the removal of foreign Jews and of Italian Libyan Jews to concentration camps in Libya was carried out successfully and had long-term consequences for the community. harsh anti-Semitism underlies this relatively vast scale operation. The Muslim foreign subjects were showed a greater benevolence, quote, greater benevolence. The Jews were instead considered as subjects of dubious loyalty. They were considered responsible for making light signals to the British enemy during the aerial attacks, spying for them, cheering for the arrival of the British forces, for speculations, black marketing, smuggling, etc. The list of accusations shows the growing anti-Semitic sentiments of the colonial rules. The plan for the removal of foreign nationals began in September 1941. General Bastico thought it was urgent to remove all foreigners, with no exception, from military areas, and therefore he began to act immediately, starting from Tripoli. We know that the urgency of the operation was dictated by the war events in Cyrenaica. Indeed, Benghazi changed hands five times between February 1941 and November 1942. Since we are dealing here with the Jews of French citizenship and Tunisian protégé français sent to the French territories of North Africa, Tunisia, Algeria, and Morocco, let me start by presenting the size of the operation for this group and set the numbers straight. Bastico states that Libya had about 7,000 foreigners of various nationalities, Jews included. He numbered for Tripolitania alone 1,600 Jews of Tunisian and French citizenship. As to Cyrenaica, Bastico gave a general figure of 2,000 foreign nationals without giving any detail as to how many were the Jews of French citizenship. The overall number of Jews displaced from Libya to French territories in North Africa was of 1,861 people, out of which the Jews from Cyrenaica were 624 people. Recent research has proven that the number given by the Italian authorities is correct. Apparently, Tunisian authorities identified 1,838 Jews who crossed the Libyan-Tunisian border at Benghazi. The operation should have started immediately according to Bastico, and it was officially approved by Mussolini in a letter of September 20th, 1941. Negotiations with the Vichy authorities conducted by CIAF, Italian Committee for the Armistice with France, started immediately in their headquarters in Turin and Tunis through the Italian Consul General Giacomo Silimbani. However, this turned to be a delicate issue. The Italians needed to justify the operation to the Tunisian and French Vichy authorities. They had to obtain their agreement and cooperation. The operation required also a complex organization. How to arrange transportation, who should be in charge, by Alcorguegra, and so forth. The negotiations dragged for a long time, at least until mid-March 1942, because the French were on the defensive and showed great reluctance to receive the mass of displaced people. They had their citizens' interests at heart, they claim. As a matter of fact, they did not know how to deal with food, supply, housing, and public security. The French were also asking for identification. What kind of identification? Who should prepare the documents? They requested to be actively involved in gathering information. The Italians were initially reluctant to cooperate on this point, but in the end they provided the necessary lists and documents. The French were adamant about receiving guarantees about the property left behind by the displaced people. The French wanted to transfer rents of properties to the new destination, and they wanted people to carry enough money for as long time as the war lasted. The Italians refused to transfer rents because it was against the war laws and set the amount of money at 450 lire, 1,000 francs, in addition to jewelry. Needless to say, the amount was insufficient even by the standards of the time. The whole operation took place in two distinct periods, from July 13 to 26 and from August 6 to 23, 1942. 2,542 French subjects and protected people, including 681 Muslims and 1,861 Jews, this is a quote, were sent to the border with Tunisia. Their arrival in Tunisia of the Jews of Libya continued throughout August 1942 and until the middle of September 1942. The Tunisian police declared that the Jews were of very modest economic conditions, being mostly elderly, children, and sick with trachoma, invalids of different nature, and few healthy adult males. The Libyans headed to Tunisia or La Marsa were 656 in number. A group of 131 Jews of Benghazi was sent to camp 5 kilometers away from the city of Sfax along the road of Agareb. A second group brought the total of Jews located in Sfax to 573, in Sousse to 35, and in Gabes to 29. The second part, what's the situation in Tunisia between 1940 and 42? In Tunisia, the anti-Jewish legislation decided by the Vichy government in France found application in the protectorate slowly but steadily. In 1939, there were at least 60,000 Jews in Tunisia, including the group holding Italian citizenship. The arrival of Libyan Jews to Tunisia caused concern and apprehension among locals. The Italian authorities neglected them, while they showed great concern with protecting the interests of the Italian group